Yeah, first map is Sands of Time, and then after that it'll be their choice. Hopefully they choose Turnian. No idea what they're going to choose. Hopefully they don't choose Comic Catcher. I'm starting to get sick of that map.
Yeah.
And by starting to, I mean I've always been kind of sick of that map. As everyone who's watched this rainy length of time knows, it's not my favorite map. I like hills. Flat ground makes me anxious. I live in a mountainous region. It's just I need hills.
Well, we've had one unusual map so far. I'd say that this is the second one. You cast a lot of games here?
I've casted a few. It was kind of popular a little while ago, but it hasn't really shown up recently. This map, all of these hills here, or dunes rather, they are very steep. As in, you cannot use vehicles here, you must use bots. Mm. And they are very powerful with defenses. You'll see people put wind gens on them. You'll see people put lotuses on them. Occasionally, defenders as well, obviously. Occasionally, stardusts. Like, these are very powerful. They're going to be used a lot.
And it's also worth mentioning, this is a very large map. The travel times are quite large, especially when you're using bots to run across the map. So, pretty common to see an early air gunship factory switch as well.
Or just air start, as Aquanim's doing.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
But that's an important thing to point out. Also, it's 12 by 12 diagonal, and you have the hills. That all contributes.
Mm-hmm.
So usually, I mean, people will end up just taking a side. Like, kind of expand in the corner, and then into one side, and then it splits down the middle.
Mm-hmm.
But I've only seen about 3 or 4 games on this map, so maybe something's changed. Maybe there's some new tech I don't know about. But Skasi still hasn't even placed their factory yet. Oh, Yogg's going for gunship. I guess Skasi's going forward with the shield bots. Okay.
Shield bots is it's an interesting choice here. I feel like it's too slow.
I agree. I mean, given the fact that you kind of need to ball up and there's so many places one could just stick a sniper.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen that happen too. It's not pretty. The only upside though is that the dunes do cover from sniper pretty well.
Yeah, that's a good point.
But the advance gets just stuffed by snipers nearby.
We're actually seeing an amphib rather than shield bot. I like that a lot better.
Wasn't even playing.
I know, amphibious units in a desert.
Well, I guess Skasi can dream. And wants to just irrigate. Like, that's his plan. He's going to throw a bunch of archers in there and then just water the entire place, try to make it
just
fertile.
Just terraform a little oasis.
Yeah. Actually, that just involves digging down, probably. Just dig down forever until you get hit water. I don't even know if that'll work. I think you can't terraform down to water on this map. I honestly don't know, but I'm fairly certain you can't. But yeah, we'll see if Skasi digs a well to try to hide their commander at some point. If they do, they'll be living the dream. And nice watch. Ooh. Yeah, because I guess they would have seen that gunship. So now they know everything coming up. And then over the Nats, we don't see any construction. The Nats just being used, I guess, as... What's it even being used for? I guess to die.
Yeah, it just happened to sink a few shots there.
And I figured
this crane isn't long for this world.
No, I was just figuring that... What I was assuming was that it was going to be used instead for Comnap. I didn't expect a trident. But well, the crane's down, but no big deal.
That would have been nice to see. Been, unfortunately, very little cheese so far.
It has been a very vanilla tournament.
Hmm.
And Banshees are coming in. Now, I mean, I'm kind of surprised at the Banshees, given how popular Rapiers have been. Like, I'm glad to see Banshees. It's just one of those things where you kind of think, is there a reason people aren't using Banshees? I mean, I realize that they don't have the same alpha damage that Rapiers do, and that is a big deal, so that's probably why.
Well, I would think in this case, the Banshees are specifically you want them because they can traverse a lot of ground and do a lot of raiding, and so if there's some sort of naked expansion going on, the Banshees are probably the best unit to punish that.
Yes, they do very well against naked expansions. So I guess they're just assuming that the map size is going to provoke naked expanding.
Mm-hmm.
But then the problem, of course, is the Swift. But the problem for that is the Trident. Nice burst. Or not burst, nice boost. That wasn't a burst at all. That was a boost.
Boosted so it didn't burst.
No. That's right. That'd be bad, because it doesn't have a strong burst. It just sort of falls and dies. Because it'd be really weird if there was an air unit that exploded like a commander. I suppose it could self-do your recon comm and jump it in the air right before it blows up.
Oh, there you go.
That'd be a really risky thing to do. But if someone won a game doing that, I'd be impressed. Like a massive air force comes in and just throw their commander in as a bomb. Go on.
Not having any trouble with these Swifts as they come in here one by one.
Well, that makes sense. The Trident's built to counter Swifts. The problem is going to be Gremlins. Gremlins such as these, for instance. First problem for them is going to be everything else, like ducks.
Also that Banshee.
That Banshee will be a bit of an issue. Oh, never mind about ducks. Man, if that Thunderbird were to stun out the Trident, it'd be risky. But it would also, help get rid of the Trident, which would be nice.
Boy, it's risky flying that Thunderbird by the Trident for no reason.
No, but the Trident's going to go to... Oh! Even trade. Trident for Swift. I don't think that was really worth it. I think the Swifts were much more valuable alive. Because at this point, another Trident's going to be built by... Oh no, Rapier's not even bothering with Tridents, realizing there's not much point in doing Tridents.
Huh.
Rapiers are safe enough.
Yeah?
I mean, against one or two Swifts at a time, yeah, it definitely is.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Of course, it does open up the Thunderbird to stun that out, but the Thunderbird wants to stun out the Ducks, so there's no reason it would stun out anything else. However, at this point, if you look at the territory control... Recursion is taking a decent chunk of the territory. They have a nice position. I mean, Yogzototh and Skasi definitely have the entire north side. And they have a fair amount of the center east. The southeast, I think, is pretty contentious, though. Recursion needs to take that ASAP. If they don't take that, it is going to bite them.
Yeah, absolutely. I can imagine Yogzototh starting to get a larger advantage here as he starts to capitalize or starts to use his cranes for that naked expansion. It's certainly, the opportunity is open for him. We haven't seen much radium from GoogleFrog to try and punish that so far, although he does have some glaives here in position, but they're mostly occupied trying to fight off these ducks.
Yeah, and I guess the Swifts are just kind of too paranoid of the Tridents to move out. Which is not unwise, but yeah, very much playing defensively from Recursion. They're just playing super defensively. And, of course, when you're playing defensively, the thing you gotta do is take the expansion territory. Slowly but surely creep out and expand.
And that is what we're seeing from Yogzototh.
Well, yeah, so I was talking about Recursion, but yes, Yogzototh is doing that. Yogzototh is playing the way you want to play if you are playing defensively. Well, Recursion, they're playing defensively, but they don't have the economy to back it up.
Oh, I see what you meant now.
Yeah. No, you're right, Yogzototh is playing that way, but they're playing that way in a way that supports that play. And there's that harassment.
There we go.
There we go.
Well, good. I'm glad to see it.
Of course, how effective it's going to be. The Swifts can't hit
Yogzototh is... Yeah, Yogzototh is going to be profiting off these mechs until these Swifts can try and whittle it down. It takes quite a while.
If they can whittle it down.
Sure, and now these Tridents coming in too. Oh boy, those Swifts are almost upside down.
Wow.
Boxed in by these Tridents now.
Yeah, bursting into death. Or boosting, rather, into death. I keep screwing that up. Boosting into death, only one survives.
Wow.
Because they kind of boosted the wrong way. They were not facing the right way during the boost. It was a very emergency boost. And unfortunately didn't work out too well.
Yep, a bit of a misboost there. Really nice pickup from Yogzototh.
Oh man, how much... That's like 2,000 metal worth of ducks alone.
I was going to say, look at this critical mass of ducks here. I mean, that's some dominant center control. Scythes, here we go. That's a good call. I really like this.
The scythes, always a good call. If you have a naked expansion setup like this.
Yep.
Yeah, there's not much that can be done to deal with them. Especially when there's multiples. One at a time, yes. That's easy enough. But when there's multiples, then it's just, you are in a checkmate situation. You are going to lose, or not in checkmate, but you are going to lose mexes. Not checkmate, it's the other situation where you have like a knight that has a king in check and then another piece nearby. Can't remember what that's called.
Oh, like a fork?
Yeah, that's it. It's a fork. That's exactly what it is. Thank you. I forgot that name. Yeah, so you get an mech fork like that, and then that works out nicely. And Yogzototh's commander is not under threat. I'm paying way too much attention to it because it's a commander. They look cool. Well, kind of. Sport combat actually looks kind of boring, but... That's good. I don't know. I don't really know what to think about the commander designs. Recon looks the coolest.
Yeah.
I don't think there are any recon comms in play. Nope. Support comm and battle and strike comm, I mean. But it looks like, I mean, at this point, if we look at Yogzototh and just overall, the forces from Yogzototh and Skasi, so I don't need them.
They've got the territory, they've got the economy, they've got the military.
They have 6,000 metal worth of military up the front lines. They have... There's not much that GoogleFrog and... There's not much that Recursion has. They're really... They must be getting tired. I mean, it's fairly late
it
in Australia.
Like we've seen... It seems like a really sluggish pace so far for Recursion through this game.
Well, it's midnight over there, so I'm not surprised.
That's a good point. I didn't think about that. Yeah, really good job on Skasi and Yogzototh's part. Securing the territory, expanding behind it. They did a little bit better at defending and punishing the naked expansions, and here we're starting to see that manifest.
And just better at expanding in general. I mean, there are expansions out in the backside that haven't been taken yet.
Yeah.
Like, Recursion in the south side has not taken some of their expansions.
Yep, you're right.
So really, at this point, I think Yogzototh and Skasi can just attack whenever they feel like it and win the game.
They truly could,
It's up to them.
The Ducks alone, I think, could do it, but the Ducks combined with this Rapier Ball over
with
here the on
the
west.
With the support, just in case more Swifts come in.
Right. Yeah, there's not much left to be done.
Yeah. The Thunderbird's the only thing that could be a slight risk if it manages to deal enough damage before... Or rather, it stuns out the Ducks before it gets killed, which is possible. That would slow things down.
See a Brawler coming in here as well, just to really pour it on. Yeah, it's pretty sticky, and I don't think Recursion is actually fully aware of the predicament they're in.
Yeah, they must be tired, because I'm just surprised they aren't expanding to the south. This is their territory over to the south, they just haven't taken it yet.
Yeah, those cons were idling forever, too. Quite a few unbuilt metal extractors.
That is rather unfortunate. It looks like GoogleFrog, do they even have any constructors right now? I don't see any. I think GoogleFrog's actually out of constructors. No, they have two in their main base, that's it. They've been also quiet for some time.
Yeah.
That's unusual. That is unlike GoogleFrog. They must be dead tired.
Yeah, I think you're right. It really just must be an issue of fatigue.
Like GoogleFrog,
maybe a bit of over-focus on the front here.
Maybe, but that's a symptom of fatigue.
Yep, very true.
That hyper-focus, that's what happens. You get tired. You start like, oh shit, this is my threat. I gotta do this. And then you realize, wait a sec, why do I only have 5 metal extractors 20 minutes into the game? Oh. GG.
Yep. Well, they do have a couple of games they can try and run it back, but
this one
is probably in the books.
Honestly, I think this is just GG now to save their energy.
That's, honestly, at this point, this late in the tournament, that would be my advice as well.
Like, that's usually the thing to do. If they have some strategy, some idea, but they don't have the money to pull it off, I can't think of any strategy they'd have that wouldn't require enough money. Because the type counters they have, like, the Thunderbird they have, but air is pretty much locked down. And, yeah, just all those Swifts bunched up and died.
Yep.
Like, air's done. There's nothing they can really do to threaten air. So yeah, I just throw it in and hope for the best for next game. Like, throw it in, go to somewhere small like Avalanche, and take it from there.
Yeah, definitely don't play another macro map like this.
No, not when you're this tired. Like, clearly they got the focus on the front line, so play a map that focuses on that, like Desert Cliffs or Avalanche or... Or what else would work?
Coming from Yogzototh.
What?
Yeah.
Okay, Skasi has a... You guys are... You've won.
Plus, we already knew that Skasi has a problem. Didn't need a pause for that.
Yeah.
Honk.
Well, apparently Skasi crashed after rejoin.
There we go.
Okay, well, that... Shouldn't take too long. They'll be about a minute or so. Oh, never mind. Get a GG from the other side.
Yeah.
It's like... Okay, so we're going to move on to game 2 on Recursion's map of choice. that will... I mean, I don't know what they're going to go for.
Yeah. Because
I don't know what they're going to be thinking. They've got... I'm sure they figure that they probably can't really go for anything too macro-oriented, but at the same time, they might figure, we'll just go for something we kind of know, like Red Comet, and then once again, the same thing happens.
Yeah, tough call. I mean, gosh, I don't even know what I'd pick. I might try just Intersection again, since it's the only one they've had luck with so far.
Well, they won two games.
Right.
It wasn't just Intersection.
What was the other map?
CCR. But that was not against this team. That was against Snugglebase.
Mm-hmm. That's right. There we go.
Yeah. That was against... No, it was against Skasi and Yogzototh. Never mind. Yeah, I think that was CCR. Because I think... No, it wasn't CCR. No. CCR is where Skasi and Yogzototh won. They won on Aquatic Divide, the very first map.
That's right.
Like, Aquanim and GoogleFrog, it was a tense match that went for 25 minutes, and they won. And then they lost in CCR, and then they won again on Intersection. So of the maps they could choose, yeah, Intersection was the best one for them.
Or, like you mentioned, just really any other smaller map. Just try to keep it from going into a super macro expansion focused mid game, because that's where they seem to be having the problems today.
Yeah, but not sure where they're gonna think to go. Oh, what, seriously?
Oh boy.
They clearly don't want me to cast the grand finals. Yeah, I'm not sure if they pick CCR again. That's kind of it for Aquanim and GoogleFrog, unless they manage to just pull up the last of their energy.
Yeah, I have to agree. A little bit of deliberation going on.
Although I wouldn't mind it if Skasi and Yogg won, just because Forever and Kloon never fought them. But have that variety.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because at this point, we've already had a repeat match. Like, one of the round ones is also... That's also the loser's finals, so...
Yeah.
That.
Yeah, but really, in this situation, I'd say the most important thing is you pick a map that plays to your strengths, and then you pick a map that's comfortable to you. You know, something that's not going to throw you off guard. Something that you know the tiny little tricks about, that your opponent's not going to be able to pull something out on you while you're playing.
Yeah, that is what I'm... So I'm confused trying to figure out which one they'd go for, because the comfortable map would be Red Comet. But that wouldn't work very well given this change in style, or given who has the advantage in style.
How about a C map?
Oh, right! Yeah, Incultum might... Oh no, Incultum would be too risky from a macro perspective. Yogzototh doesn't like C, but they're not bad at it.
Maybe Coastal? Something like that?
Yeah, Coastal could work. Also still kind of risky due to the size, but yes, that would be more up their... sort of their alley, in the sense that they wouldn't have to worry so much about where they are.
And it, you know, it might throw a monkey wrench into Yogzototh's...
Flooded Valley! You were close!
There we go.
I don't think I've seen this in a tournament before.
Love it. Yeah, I don't think I have either. This is a really interesting call. But this is the right thing to do, definitely. You've got to throw Skasi and Yogzototh out of their comfort zone.
Yeah, because like I said, Yogzototh... I'm not sure about Skasi so much. I'm pretty sure they don't. Most people don't. But Yogzototh, I know, doesn't like water. And GoogleFrog is fairly comfortable in it.
Mm-hmm.
So that seems to make sense. So GoogleFrog is probably going to go for Hover. Aquanim, I think it's 50-50 whether they go for Amphib or Gunship. And then on Skasi and Yogzototh's side, Yogg's probably going to go for Shipyard. Skasi, I'm not sure.
I kind of expect to have a ships from each team recently. That seems to be the dominant C meta.
That's a possibility, yeah. I mean, Flooded Valley is definitely a map that could make that work. It's also a tiny map. That's the one thing. It's so small that while ships can work, it's got this weird... It's small, but the center island is almost inaccessible to the center by ships.
Yeah, that's a good point.
So it could work. I can imagine one player going for it, but I don't know if one player from each team is going to go for it.
Well, we're about to find out.
Yep. Going to see how much I pulled that out of my hat.
Oh, it's so refreshing to see, you know, like a new type of map, one that we don't usually see in tournaments.
Especially this map, because, okay, it's a C map, and C maps have a bad rap, but this, I think, is a cool map. I kind of like this map.
Yeah, me too. I've always had a little special place in my heart for it. It's hard to figure out, you know, I think part of the reason it doesn't get played so much, or maybe the reason C maps in general don't get played so much, is because it makes people uncomfortable, because they're so used to playing on land and having that sort of... Yeah, and flat maps and land factory type of mindset that trying to fit that or sort of, I don't know, try and translate that into a C game. Yeah, exactly. It's, well, like I said, it makes you uncomfortable.
It does. It can.
I know that was my own experience.
Yeah, it's different. Although, given how popular hovers and amphibs have been on non-C maps, I would think it'd be a lot easier for people to transition now. I mean, shipyards are a different thing, but otherwise, it's... basically the same set of units. You just have to think about the fact that amphibs have different properties underwater.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. And it's a lot better now, but in the past especially, the characteristic differences between the underwater amphibious weapons and their counterparts on land were pretty significant.
That was a thing.
To the point where they were essentially, you know, nearly different units.
Particularly scallops. That was really annoying.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think it's still roughly the same, though. But yeah, the fact that scallops just... had this weird depth chargey thing that never worked properly.
At least now they're like, you could reasonably call it a riot weapon. You know, before it was almost exclusively a skirmish.
Yeah, although it looks like my guess was somewhat inverted. Aquanim is going for an amphib, but it's like Yogzototh and Skasi, they went for hover and amphib. GoogleFrog is going for ships.
Oh, there we go.
Yeah.
Jumping out here, there we go. All right.
So ships and amphib. So yeah, my exact predictions, but flipped. Except no gunships. Oh, I never predicted Skasi either. But yeah. Still, hover amphib is a thing.
Well, all right.
Powerful thing too. Which kind of makes sense. Sorry, go on.
I'm always curious to see how people start off with their ship factory. Submarines make sense here. Probably expecting to see some amphibs. But it's always a tough call. Do you want to go for anti-sub or anti-surface?
Well, it doesn't really matter though, because subs hit surface. Like, submarines can hit the dagger, the dagger can hit the submarine. Same with ducks. Like, ducks can hit
unless the dagger is on an island.
Oh yeah, of course. That's true. But that's what the amphib's for.
Also true.
But these are extremely shallow waters, that's the one thing. Like the submarine is very nearly scraping the bottom of the sea. Which thankfully isn't a problem, but yeah, it's not hard to hit for the ducks. Also, I'm kind of wondering if the fact that when it pops above water like that, if that actually makes a difference. Like, if it actually can be seen briefly. That'd be interesting. I doubt it, but it'd be interesting if it was.
Yeah, really interesting. I don't know the subtleties of the sea mechanics, but there's quite a few things like that. I don't really know the answer to.
And sadly, we can't easily find out. However, my guess is that it doesn't, because it's probably just based off of raw visibility rather than being based off of, is it above or below water?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's a good point.
Because if it did that, then it'd have to show that it's there, even if it's just slightly above water, in which case it comes down to whether or not the water is actually doing a depth pass that cuts off things underwater. And that's something you can easily work around by just not having a depth pass for the refraction effect. But a Crusader coming in for GoogleFrog very early on wants to have this island. I mean, they already secured the island, but I guess to be able to go from there to attack the bases directly.
Boy, that seems risky to me. It's going to be so vulnerable to the amphibious units.
Those ducks are going to be terrifying as far as that goes.
Oh, yeah.
But really everything. And actually, nice, very nice harassment coming from the back here. Dagger's getting rid of all the ducks.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Not even getting hit in an efficient way either. So these daggers have survived very long. And Yogzototh not able to take the center though. Their commander's under some threat. But still, that Crusader's going to have, like I said, a tough time. As it is, it's already Aquanim's having to rebuild everything just in the main base. Although, they got a lot of reclaim. They're good.
With the Aquanim's ducks getting thinned out like that, there's not going to be any amphibs up here to help defend this crusader, so it's very vulnerable to these few ducks that are right next to it.
It doesn't look like depth charges, though.
Oh, that's right, that's right.
Yeah, it's not completely defenseless. It's not great. I forgot. It's no hunter, but it's there.
That's right, it can still at least deal some damage.
Yeah. The issue that might come up would be whether or not it's able to deal enough damage. Like, if there are too many ducks that just tear it to shreds before it can do anything. Then again, it doesn't need to go that far. Like, it'll need to end up around here-ish. Oh, you can't really see where I'm pointing. But basically around the same distance as that quill is away from the base.
Mm-hmm.
And that should manage most things. Hit that urchin? Nope! Missed the urchin. Looks like... Are they... Yeah, the radar's off. That's why. And that's where the problem comes in. The daggers are the bigger problem. Like, the urchin's great for that, but the daggers are the one that is almost impossible to deal with. They don't have, the depth charges won't help. And neither will the shells. Ouch. Oh, but that quill's not quite dead. Sheesh, how did that not die? My goodness. So yeah, the Crusader is the one thing that's really keeping them in right now. Because raid coming in along the northwest is... Is that going to go in Aquanim's favor? Yeah, it will. Just barely, but still a lot of ducks lost. But inside Aquanim's territory, so it's all good.
Very good point.
While at the same time, Yogg-Soth and Skasi are claiming a proxy expansion right here. Very risky. I think this is going to go down. I think Aquanim sees this. Is going to take it out. Yep, they got it. They're good. Alright, so that's... They got their territory.
A little bit greedy there, but...
Skasi and Yogg-Soth just have no respect for them. At all. It's obvious. They just have zero respect.
A little bit flippant there.
Yeah.
But
Ooh, and a Mariner taken out too, so... GoogleFrog's attempts to build up, I guess, rebuild that expansion or build further beyond. Those are getting stuffed pretty hard. Overall, though, I think that... It's... Like, hard to really gauge. The economy is very reclaim-focused on this map, but Yogg-Soth and Skasi have already reclaimed their main base, whereas there's still a fair amount of resources in the main base for recursion.
Yep.
But then, of course, the other problem is that this Crusader, it's done damage, but it's only just now getting to the main base, and GoogleFrog, as you can see, is just crawling along with the urchins to make sure that it's not being threatened too hard.
Yep. This is, I mean, his really... Only significant defense against the amphibious units is going to be these urchins here. He's relying on the Crusaders to try and thin out the urchins over on the side, presumably to open up an avenue to attack through, but
then there's the halberds.
He's wasting time here. Yeah,
and
exactly.
The halberds are the biggest problem because, okay, the torpedoes are nice, but the halberds just don't care.
Those halberds are, I mean, they're perfect for sniping out one or two of these Crusaders.
And GoogleFrog making a hard read on air switch, which is incorrect. There is no air switch coming right now. I suppose it'll help possibly in the future, but they don't have much resource, like 280 metal being thrown on air. But it could be thrown on a handful of hunters or a handful of serpents or anything like that. That was not probably, or not even, typhoons against the daggers? You want typhoons.
Yep, absolutely.
And they aren't building that. In a That's 220
pretty
metal
defensive
each,
posture here with these tucks out front of the base, but you can see Yogg-Soth looks like he's getting ready for an attack up the east side.
Yeah, and the thing is, that razor could have been a typhoon, and that typhoon would have torn apart this entire dagger ball. Well, what little there is of it. Because it's about the same cost.
Yep.
And now the ducks. How good are those depth charges? That's the question here. Are they going to do the trick? Because these skeeters are not.
Those urchins should help out quite a lot with the ducks.
Oh, they'll help out, but it comes down to the numbers. Although Yogg-Soth's commander is about to go down, and this map, the economy on this map is fairly weak.
Yep,
especially static
thin.
Economy. It's quite the famine, but Yogg-Soth's commander, one more hit and they're down. But at the same time, this harassment, they aren't going to go down without a fight. This harassment going pretty well? Yeah, it's going pretty well. Taking out the energies they can. But those Crusaders, now they're in position. Now GoogleFrog's in place. Nice shot. Got rid of the commander and should be able to get rid of the factory fairly soon. And yep, Skasi Yogg-Soth throwing the towel. We are going to CCR.
Hey. Well, this is familiar.
But yeah, that was cool. Flooded Valley. Glad to see it. Yeah, that urchin that was, crawl. Man, that must have been terrifying kind of for Yogzototh and Skasi as well, because it's a clock. I mean, they had to know.
Yeah, it really is. Boy, that was just such a solid strategy, really well executed by GoogleFrog. That's tricky, you know? How do you dislodge that if you're Skasi and Yogzototh?
Well, I think they had a decent idea, but the halberds would have been like a few more halberds in order to distract what's going on and then rush in with the ducks to distract the urchins. So the urchins are firing all the halberds and then the ducks can come in. And if the urchins decide, oh, wait, no, the ducks are a better target, the halberds open up and fire.
Yep. And that's definitely the way to do it. Yeah.
Yeah, they had the units to do it too. It was just, I think, a micro thing.
Yep. Just needed to, coordinate a bit better. That's, once again, it comes down to the importance of spiking at the right time in a 2v2. And that was definitely the right time to do it.
Yeah. I have this strange feeling. I showed the map to people, right? Like, I was actually... People saw the game, right? I didn't just have it on the screen. I had it on this screen the entire time, didn't I? No one saw the game, did they?
Oh, boy. You're asking the wrong...
Wow. The one map I wanted to show off. Well, this is what happened. I'm sorry you didn't see it. Please tell me when you don't see the game. I can't know if you guys aren't... I can know, but there's so many things to look at. But please let me know if the game isn't showing. Like, were you guys able to watch the game? Oh. I forgot there's a 2-minute delay. Great. That's just perfect. That was such a good strategy too, with this urchin crawl, and I think it was just lost. Great. That's just... Oh, no, they're going to Tabula. Oh, something different.
Oh?
Yeah, something different.
Yeah, something different for sure. This is, not typically considered a 2v2 map anyway.
Yeah. Times like this, I kind of wish I had staff. With a larger audience.
Need an intern.
What? No, I can do this. I don't need to leave yet. I feel so silly. Just make sure... Show you guys the loading screen. Just so I absolutely know for sure the bracket results aren't getting in the way. That was embarrassing. I hate when I do that. It always happens at least once, and I feel terrible about that. It's like the worst unprofessional thing that I can do. Show the game.
Worry about it. guys. By the way, Yogzi, just like to collectively refer to them as a team. I don't know. Anyway, the Eastern team, since they didn't plop an air factory. Yeah, I like that. But since they didn't plop an air factory, they're not going to be able to punish the naked expansion by cranes as easily. So I think that Aquanim just needs to crank out one or two, then area mechs, and he should be able to...
Scallop drop.
All right. Good. That works for me, man. Not sure about these blast wings, though. Maybe just trying to deny the scout.
Probably. I mean, that's what you gotta do. It's cheese.
Boy, these positions are awfully far away, though, for a cooperative cheese. And they're spending an awful lot of money on these metal extractors and defenses. Just a 2 scallop drop. Interesting.
Yeah, that's gonna be...
Okay, I like this.
But it's gonna get spotted out. There's a... Oh, no, never mind. That's their blasting. My mistake. Red and yellow are allied. Oops. Silly me. But yeah, I think it's pretty clear, though, because none of the metal extractors are taken. And GoogleFrog's base, that's super unusual. GoogleFrog never plays like that. I'm sure they know if GoogleFrog does not have their metal extractors up by the first minute, something is fishy. But they aren't really
They're not reacting like they know what's going on. And Yogzototh's commander could be having a bad day.
Yogzototh's commander is probably going to be okay.
Going to be fine. Yeah, those scalps definitely overshot.
The factory, on the other hand.
Maybe taking out the factory? No.
No, they didn't put it in position.
Now that's worked there. That's unfortunate. There were so many good targets there,
but yeah.
These two constructors up front would have been a nice pickup instead.
Okay, what is... Apparently you can't get audio. I'm not sure what's going on there. I mean, I'm seeing the levels. The levels look good. So as far as I know, everything's good. One sec. Okay. Okay, good. It's whatever. They got it back. It was just... That was a fluke of hitbox, unfortunately. That's weird.
Yeah,
that never
happened to me before, too.
Okay. That's what I figured. It was just them, because I'm seeing the levels fine. Like, it has happened with a level stop, but who cares about that, because there are Banshees killing Glaze right now, because they need to recover. The failed scallop drop. Second failed scallop drop. We haven't had a successful drop of tonight. In the very first match, we had a failed... Well, not even a failed. It was an aborted scallop drop.
Yeah, yeah.
And now it's just a scallop drop that they went for it. And it got... The Valkyrie got killed too soon.
Mm-hmm.
That was the problem. The Valkyrie got shot down. So it wasn't that it overshot. It was just... It just got shot down. The Lotus killed it.
I see. I thought that he might have manually released them.
No. The Valkyrie blew up. If you notice the whole triangle particle thing, the Valkyrie was destroyed.
Well, we are seeing this naked crane expansion, like I mentioned, so it wasn't an overcommitment, I think, to that scallop drop.
I think they're kind of trying to use the Banshees to make up for the scallop drop. Like, there is, to me, a bit of a sense that there is an attempt to make up for a fail play.
Yeah.
And that's working okay so far. Nothing has actually threatened that expansion. But at the same time, the Banshees are not really doing much yet.
Pretty big wave of Glaives coming up here from the south.
Yeah, they're going to be coming along trying to get rid of that expansion too. Some of them are, at least. Or, no, they're not. No, what? Pulling
back. Wow.
That's not the best move. That expansion is totally naked.
Yep, attacking is definitely the right call here. I mean, honestly, attacking into the base is fine right now.
Okay, it looks like one of the Glaives is going towards the expansion with his pants down. The rest of them are getting concerned about splash damage. What are they doing? Nothing's going to hit you. Just,
oh boy.
You can go.
All this delay. Yeah, that was such a juicy target there.
This happens a lot, I've noticed.
Yep.
It's like, scout.
It's so
you got
true.
A scout.
Exactly. Information is, you know, this could have been such a huge play, but they just didn't know. They didn't know it was there to take advantage of. And there's so many situations like this.
Yeah, and another drop, maybe? Another Valkyrie.
Yep.
Another drop possibility.
One thing I've seen GoogleFrog do is use Valkyries to transport his constructors on large maps like this.
Oh, that's true, yeah.
They could expand more quickly, yeah.
Ouch. Well, the Glaive's certainly doing a pretty decent job, but yeah... Oh, Gremlin got spotted? That sucks.
Ouch.
Yep, there goes the anteater. Now the Banshee is pretty much... it's going to go in? I mean, are they going to call it? I think Akram's going to call it. There's no Gremlins. And they'd be wrong. New ones joined the party. But even then, it's just... Yeah, at this point, I'd say... Really, it's coming down to the fact that Recursion actually has more territory. They just haven't claimed it yet.
Mm-hmm.
And now, as you can see, yeah, the Valkyrie is being used to transfer the... As you mentioned, to transfer the worker. That's what it does.
Interesting. There's also a couple more Valkyries stockpiled out here towards the center. Maybe he's just trying to keep his options open.
That, or possibly trying to make them scared. Like, oh they're going to go for another drop? Oh, crap.
Or he could be just using them as a ferry route here. It looks like. I see that they're on guard on this factory. So I think he's going to be using them to ferry these buoys up to the front line.
Oh, yeah, that would work. Yeah, right, because the guard system works properly now.
Good to see. I love this type of stuff.
Well, okay, in theory, it works. I don't see it actually happening. I think GoogleFrog's going to have to rewrite that slightly. Apparently a bug has manifested itself. Because that's a new widget, so I'm not surprised. Actually, what I'm a little surprised about, come to think of it, is that GoogleFrog has not done any circle guarding. Because that was a big deal. That was a big thing that's showing off. Like, oh, hey, yeah, I've got this new circle guard widget. You're going to do guard command, put in a circle around something, and I can't do it because I'm a spectator, but... And put it in a guard around something, and then it'll just circle around it. And it'll look cool. I'm not using that. Kind of expected they would. Oh well. At any rate, at this point, Recursion's just falling behind economically. They just have the territory they haven't converted.
Yep.
That's the problem. It's that territory economy conversion, and now it's become economy to military conversion. And they've only got a couple minutes before they're going to run out of military advantage.
Wow, that greedy start from Yogzototh. I mean, he opened up with two constructors very, very early, sent them straight forward, completely undefended, and wasn't punished for it. And so here you can see the results of that, where he's just expanded really without issue well into the mid part of this map. And has a huge force of slashers now to try and erode away GoogleFrog's position up here to the north.
Mm-hmm. Ooh, now, where dropping would be very nice.
Yeah, this would be the perfect... Oh!
Boy drop,
just
I think.
A buoy. Just a buoy on the way in.
Yeah. At max range, too.
Huh.
Not sure I understand that. Any closer would force them to move. Although, I suppose the glaives are a big threat, so there's that. Oh, I see. So, yeah, I guess the guard order is helping out there. Yep, the guard order is working. Never mind. Everything's good. That is good. I guess I wonder if ferry routes are even needed anymore, but I guess they kind of are for non-factory stuff. Anyway, go on.
Just that I like these buoys against the slashers, but there's nothing really here to deal with the scorchers and the glaives behind them. I mean, at this point, just another example of how Yogzototh and Skasi were able to expand without punishment at first, and now it's just going to snowball, it seems like. Mm-hmm. Unless GoogleFrog can do something different here, but... Seems to be running out of options.
Yeah, they're relying a lot on overdrive compared to the others, compared to blue team. Just not going to work out that well. Which is unfortunate. But I suppose it's understandable. I mean, it just still seems weird that they did not consolidate territory that they had. Especially with the cranes, the naked expansion they could do.
Yeah, it seemed like they were expanding, you know, at least as quickly, if not more quickly.
Well, they had territory. They had a position.
Mm-hmm.
But they've lost it. And no scallops or anything, so trying to hold on to it is even harder. As the boys are all going to go down, and then after that, it's going to be pretty much the base. I mean, Emergency Reaper, but even then, I don't know. And Banisher.
Yeah, I mean, the Reapers will help with the slashes, but those were nearly a solved problem anyway.
I think going for the slashers more than the scorchers. Oh, so yeah, sorry, you're right. The slashers, yes, the scorchers are the problem. Banishers are the solution. Sort of, kind of, not really.
Oh, these scorchers trying to do the run by. Diving
and
in on the banisher instead.
Well, sort of. They killed the banisher. Oh, well. Killed a banisher. Actually, they failed. Never mind.
All right. Well, this banisher sure paid off.
Yeah. On the other hand, nice glaive. Like, some nice windmills you have here. Shame if something should happen to them.
Oh, boy. Yeah, this glaive is living the dream. This is what every glaive dreams of doing when he grows up.
Yep, walks off the factory floor and says, I'm going to be the one to find the wind generator farm and smash them all to pieces. And then gets ripped apart by a duck. That glaive died happy.
Exactly.
It was the happiest glaive ever. It served its purpose in life.
I would say a warrior's death, but it was actually a glaive's death.
It was, yes. A warrior's death is getting hit by about half a dozen glaives, forgetting that at that point the counter structure reverses. That's usually how warriors tend to die. Although here's a bunch of warriors that are soon going to die. I suppose the other warrior's death, of course, is the Rocco. Or skirmishers in general.
Yep.
The warrior's death is one they didn't see coming. As was just demonstrated very aptly twice in a row. But yeah, it does appear that they are breaking out of those heavyweight units. I mean, this doesn't make sense. There has been some complaints about how light vehicles may have a hard time dealing with heavyweights. So where are the dummies?
Yep.
Because that's what people have been citing as the answers. Dominatrix.
Yogg actually just going for a completely different solution. These rapiers are another good solution to the heavy units.
Oh, yeah.
3.6k all pulled up here in the center, so...
Yeah, a dozen rapiers are going to be a big deal.
Once he feels like moving out, this is going to be dispatching that grizzly pretty quickly. Oh, heading up to the north instead to raid with.
That kind of makes sense. I mean, why hit the grizzly if you don't have to?
Yeah.
There's a bunch of open areas.
Yeah, especially if you can swing around to the north here and just get straight into the base.
Yeah, and tear apart what little economy they have.
Mm-hmm.
Economy they have. I knew English. But it broke up with me. Okay, so with that, I mean, it's good Valiant Effort back in. It's certainly... Okay, there we go. Moving the Grizzly forward. It's like, Valiant Effort, but what are they doing with it?
Yep.
They gotta take this stuff out before it gets consolidated again. They don't have territory. Like, they don't have the position to work with, and it looks like... Okay, still 14 rapiers. Oh, no, never mind. More are still being built. Where's the gunship factory? Ah, proxy gunship factory. Yeah, those rapiers are going to be a problem. And now the ducks in their last stand. Well, sort of. Once again, they couldn't really do anything about that. That's just sad. But that's ducks. There was no anglers there. Surprisingly, actually. No anglers, no tridents. There are copperheads, but no tridents. Oh, there are tridents now. Never mind. Just two. But still, even if they get rid of this, it's like... I don't know. Yogg-Soth and Skasi have such a massive... They have double the economy. They have a military advantage. The heavy units have helped because they were kind of optimized for anti-lightweight, but even then, breaking through that is going to be very difficult for recursion. Not impossible, just an uphill battle. I mean, if Yogg-Soth and Skasi put their mind to it, they could just switch over to Ulti or switch over to... Even just a few Dantes would do it. Because that would just finish everything off. I mean, Ultimatum would be perfect.
Yeah, Ultimatum... Well, it would be perfect, just like you said. These Rapiers can certainly do it, too.
Yeah. Especially with... Well, the Grizzly's going to take out two or three of them every shot. Or not quite take out. Damage. Wow, they're actually doing a terrible job of hitting. Okay, so every time they hit, they take out two or three. It's just hitting is the problem. But yeah, so at this point, Yogg-Soth and Skasi, large economy, not a whole lot of production in the right type counters, and ultimatums coming up, three ultimatums coming up.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I thought one was too many. Now, if they don't accept the first ultimatum, they got two more in reserve. I don't know why you need more than one, but there you go. Just being prepared.
Boy, I mean, Recursion's putting up such a good effort here to defend the center, but they've already lost the north and the south. There's just such a huge territorial and now economic advantage for the eastern side.
I think what they're trying to do is just cut through the center. Like, slice the center and then take north or south from there. I think that's what they're trying to do, is sweep around like that. Because they can't easily take north or south. Their units that they're using, the ones they're primarily focusing on, can't really go along the hills. It's not going to work very well. But what they can do is rip apart the center, and actually get rid of the proxy factor too, which would be quite nice. Rip apart the center, and then use that position to advance on the sides. Because sure, they can be flanked, but it's also chopping the forces in half. So it's kind of the risk. If the flank fails, they successfully have the split the forces. I think they're going for Divine
Conquer.
There's
the dummy.
You mean
wow,
the
two Reapers with one shot.
Yep.
No problems whatsoever.
Not there, no. Ooh, those gremlins are being a pain in the butt. But yeah, the Reapers, that sucks for them. Of course, the question afterwards is, where is the other ultimatum? Where are the... I mean, there's two now. The third one's in production. That's pretty scary. But even then, Recursion has a fair amount of money. They can keep rebuilding these. Right, they're
not
far behind.
They are being fairly stubborn, so it looks like the eastern side is going to need something a little bit more heavy-duty to wrap things up. Yeah.
Like a Bantha. They have 130. They have plus 130 metal in total.
Yeah.
They could build a Bantha. I mean, okay. Yeah. Yogg-Sothoth only has probably about 60 or so. Like 70. No. 135. They have 72, but... Sorry, 67. But... Yeah, a Bantha or something big like that. Where is it? Yeah, Bantha. 10,000 metal, but they have... They have enough, especially if they get some assistance in there. Wow, one ultimatum went down without dealing too much damage. Possibly both? I mean, at this point, they're... Ultimatum mono spam is the order. Well, not quite mono spam. Ultimatum spam is the order of the day. Words I never thought I'd put together in that sentence. Yes, we are seeing ultimatum spam.
It's true.
But we aren't seeing much else. And I am at this point very surprised that we aren't either seeing something like a Bantha or a silencer or even attack nuke silo. Just to EMP everything out. Like, shockly all these things out with attack nuke silo. Or just silencer them. And GoogleFrog's commander, well, was in a bad spot. Now it's just a pile of debris. That was weird. Not sure why I was up front like that. Might have been a misclick. Still, it no longer is.
Well, things seem to have
stabilized.
Evened out slightly in the center, yeah. I mean, economically, it's still a runaway game, but GoogleFrog has been making some progress here.
Yeah,
despite those ultimatums and the snipers coming in.
Yeah, they're still pushing back, but the thing is, the longer they wait, the more that other things can happen to stuff their divide and conquer strategy, or to just, like I said, some sort of mass wipe. I mean, that'd be the thing I would think to do when you have this much money. And that much territory. But another ultimatum is up. Still not in the best position. Like, the Grizzlies really don't help the ultimatum situation. Because they're tougher than the ultimatum shot. Like, they can survive an ultimatum shot, because it's only 8,000 damage, I think. Sorry, it's only 1,200. Okay, I don't know what the damage increase versus large units is, but still, I guess it must be a few, like a factor of probably 4 or 5. Which wouldn't be enough to kill a Grizzly. So I guess they survive that, and then of course the long range shot just finishes them. So overall, yeah, that's working out kind of nicely. A bit of a slow grind, but they are pulling it back.
Oh, wow. Do you see these sides here in the southwestern corner?
Nope. Okay, that's a really good call. Wow, is that a good call.
That is quite the play. And that is a long walk for those sides, too.
Well, they're going for the fusion reactors, of course, in the factories. Like, stop those Reapers from being built. Like, okay, the ultimatum's not working. Just cut it off at the source.
Interesting. I'm surprised there's not at least one side picking off these windmills, metal extractors.
There are. Two of them are going up here, but they wanted to probably have at the same time.
There we go.
They didn't give it away. and Optimus Commander there. The fusion burst will kill them, though. Fortunately, did not get out of the way in time, so that fusion burst, that slows down the Sizes all quite a lot.
Skasi actually brought along a constructor, so he's going to be able to set up maybe an LLT or a defender up here to take out the rest of these.
Mm-hmm.
That will leave Recursion without any energy infrastructure to speak of.
Yeah, because they already lost the stuff over to the northwest, and now they're losing to the southeast. Now the center's falling. The Grizzlies are all dead. Did the ultimatum finally work? I guess the ultimatum must have finally worked out. Yeah. So that's it. That was game three. What a game it was.
Wow. That was
at least
good series,
I showed that one. Everyone got to see that one. Can't feel bad about that. You all got to see that one. That was cool. That was a good game.
That was a good one. Yeah.
Although I still think that it was like that early thing really held them back. The heavy unit switch was good. I don't know, but at that point it's just, you're under so much pressure trying to figure out what to do from there.
Yep.
Yeah. But I think if it weren't for the side, they probably would have slowly ground their way back in. Because the ultimatums were kind of a losing proposition.
Yeah, that's a good point. Those sides were definitely the nail in the coffin.
They really were. And that was impressive. So that is up to Grand Finals, and it is about time for me to go, probably, because the Grand Finals will likely take about an hour, especially if there's a run back, which I feel sad about, because I wanted to see them. But I have things I must do, and places I must go, and they're far away and have bad parking.
Real life obligations. Parking realities, man. It's age-old enemies of RTS games.
That's news to me. Anyway, so I hope you enjoyed that. I don't know if you're going to be streaming on your own, Kaen, because I'm not running this. Like, you can't control it from here. So unfortunately, we're going to have to stop here, which sucks. And also,
oh my gosh,
like I said,
this is so heartbreaking.
I can't cast these until maybe tonight. Like, if not tonight, then I think Wednesday. Like, I'm sorry. I'm just not going to be able to get to the finals quickly enough. It's just, I have a super busy weekend.
All right. So anyway. Well, I forgive you.
Oh, and Orphelius is, can we postpone finals? Okay, apparently Skasi only has 30 minutes for themselves, too.
Oh.
So, huh? the finals are being proposed to be postponed.
Well, that would be convenient.
Yes, it would. Well, anyway, I guess that's my vote. But I need to be off, so thank you all for watching, and if we do have the finals sometime, then I'll post that up that we have the finals. Otherwise, we will not have the finals, and I guess they'll just have fun, and I'll watch the replays later and cast it for you guys, probably either this Wednesday or maybe this evening if I don't end up doing something. This evening, I have no plan set in stone, but that's still in like 8 hours, so yeah. Anyway, also the YouTube video is going to take a long time to be split up. Don't expect those for a little while. I'm sorry. That's kind of why I don't want to do it Wednesday. There's going to be some delays in the streaming overall for a little while. But that news aside, thanks again for watching. Thank you for helping me out, Kaen.
You bet.
And that is going to be it for me tonight. So good
night,
everyone.
Take care.